So we're now going to begin our second session of the forum. This part of the conversation will focus on perceptions of the transatlantic alliance more broadly. And at the top, I will share some of the recent findings we've just published today, a commissioned national opinion poll about perceptions of US-UK ties. We're very honored to be joined by Tom Fletcher, who's the principal of Hertford College at Oxford University. Tom has served as foreign policy advisor to three prime ministers, no less, and was also UK ambassador to Lebanon. In addition to his role at Hertford College, he is a visiting professor at NYU and chair of the International Advisory Council of the Creative Industries Federation, which promotes Britain's most dynamic and magnetic sectors overseas. Sewell Chan, a Marshall Scholar from 1998, will be leading this fireside chat. Sewell is the editorial page editor for the Los Angeles Times, where he oversees the editorial board and the op-ed and Sunday opinion pages. Sewell previously worked for many years at the New York Times, where he was a Metro reporter, the Washington correspondent, deputy op-ed editor, and also international news editor, I believe, based in London. So to kick off their conversation, we're actually going to share just a very top-level overview of some of the results from the opinion poll. So we're going to share the screen. David Elitzer will kindly put on a couple of graphs here that I'll just scroll through. In addition, in your chat should be a link to the full comprehensive poll, which you can peruse on our website and the Emerson College website at your leisure. So I'm not going to take too much time on this, but just to give you a sense, we found that, interestingly, over the 3 years that we've run this poll, there is increasing commitment to the US-UK alliance and a belief that it is ever more important. We have a couple of lighter questions, such as, did the move of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle make any impact on our special relationship? And the answer, according to most Americans, is no. But we have a couple more substantive questions as well, such as views by Americans on whether Brexit has had an impact on the alliance. And you can see that most people felt it did not have a negative impact, or didn't have an impact that they felt was significant. In addition, there were some questions about which country out of many remains our most strategic partner and valuable ally. And as you can see, the purple being 2020, there is an increasing sense that the UK is our most important ally. We had some questions regarding business and trade opportunities. And you can see that while China remains the strongest, there is some reduction in the belief that China is the most attractive country for business and trade opportunity over time, and there is an increase in the UK. And commensurate with that is an idea that is the responses that we received showing that there is increased view that the UK. Potential UK-US free trade agreement will have a positive impact in various aspects of the US, including the economy, the job market, and specifically global leadership. So I am going to turn it over to Sewell and Tom, both to reflect briefly on these results and also more broadly on where we things stand right now with this special relationship and what the future looks like for that alliance. And as a reminder to the audience, if you can just continue to put your questions in the Q&A box, Sewell and Tom will address them throughout the conversation. So I will turn it over without ado to Sewell Chan and Tom Fletcher. Thank you so much.
Nell, thank you so much for that gracious introduction and for presenting these top-level findings. I just want to say, as a Marshall Scholar and alum, that I found the found the relationship, the transatlantic relationships, especially fortifying and especially meaningful these last few years during this time of tremendous upheaval and turmoil in so many parts of the world, of course, this year especially. Tom, welcome, and thank you so much for taking the time to share your thoughts with us. Your book, The Naked Diplomat, which I gather was published under the title Naked Diplomacy in the UK, is really a fascinating and stimulating read, and you have just such a proven ability to kind of communicate complex ideas to a wide audience. Tom, I'm curious of what struck you the most about these findings. You know, I found in particular the kind of public opinion tends not to change that much year to year in normal times, but these are not normal times. And it seemed that over the last 4 years in particular, there had been some real shifts in American public opinion with respect to both Britain and China. Could you comment on that?
Well, thank you, Sewell, and thanks, Nell. And it's great to join you all this evening. I'm hoping that somewhere out there are some Hertford College alumni as well. I've been here 3 or 4 weeks, and so we're in the middle of trying to set things up for the arrival of students on Sunday. For the new term, which as you can imagine is a huge challenge. But I was fascinated by this poll, and I suppose the good news from the perspective of someone who's worked in diplomacy and cares passionately about that US-UK relationship is the resilience of those figures around US-UK. And that's despite, I have to say, probably a period in which many Brits worry about whether we really do share as many values as we thought we did, partly because of the direction that has been taken by the current US president. So it's really good to see that despite that, I think there is that underlying strength of that relationship. A number of us, and certainly when I was in Downing Street, banned the use of the word special relationship. In the UK media, every single visit, every encounter between a US president and a UK prime minister, someone put their hands up and say, do you believe that the special relationship is as strong as it was? And of course, it's a very hard thing to define. And often what they'd be asking really was, you know, are you as close as Thatcher and Reagan were, or Bush and Blair? And if you indicated that...
Or Roosevelt and Churchill.
Roosevelt and Churchill, exactly. And for the British Prime Minister, if you were that close, then you got attacked for being some sort of poodle of the American leadership. And if you weren't, you were attacked for being, you know, hopeless at diplomacy and having ruined the special relationships. You simply couldn't win. And in my time in Downing Street, we had a number of times where, you know, we had one meeting that Barack Obama and Gordon Brown had in the basement of the UN, actually in the kitchen of a UN building as they were leaving. And the media thought this was a huge humiliation for Gordon Brown because, you know, why? And they dubbed it, you know, the pizza meeting. And we got such a terrible reaction from our media that Barack Obama actually called Gordon Brown on the plane on the way back and just said, you know, I don't know how you cope with your media. So that sensitivity exists. I suspect it exists much more on our side than on the US side. So if any Brit reading this, we're reassured about that resilience, about the fact the numbers are even going in the right direction on US-UK. I think as a subset of that, I was quite struck that Brexit doesn't really seem to trouble the figures very much. You know, you get a sense that actually people don't see this as a big factor in the wider relationship. Whereas in the UK, if you're a fan of Brexit, you basically say, we're gonna get the best trade deal in the world. Donald Trump has said we're at the front of the queue. You know, the US relationship will be stronger because of Brexit. If you're opposed to Brexit, then you say, we're never gonna get a trade deal. America doesn't care about us anymore. We've lost the one utility we had to the Americans, which was as a bridge to Europe. And Joe Biden is never gonna do a trade deal with us because he's much more pro-European and pro-Irish in this case than pro-Boris Johnson. So the American relationship is deployed all the time to support one view or the other on Brexit. Actually, for me, what this poll shows is that probably most Americans aren't really that bothered either way, but most certainly most of those polled. And I think the third big factor, as you touched on, is clearly around the US-China relationship and the really choppy waters that is currently going through. And it's clear that people still regard China as the key economic trading opportunity, although maybe not so much as in the past. but that wider trust and that sense of partnership is really falling away. And I have to say that I suspect that that will remain the case in future polls. I think in this respect, whereas many in Europe and Britain are waiting for American values to reassert themselves if there is a change of American president, I suspect that the US-China relationship isn't going to suddenly be in much calmer waters under a President Biden.
That's very perceptive. Maybe we can stay on China for a moment. There's certainly a sense, I think, in Washington and in the US more generally that the conditions are worsening. Some have called it a new Cold War. I would be very curious for your perspective on what role Britain plays, not only in its own, you know, bilateral relationship with China, but also as kind of a bulwark of democracies at a time when so much news out of China seems quite grim. Of course, the crackdown on freedom of expression in Hong Kong, but also the repression and internment going on in Xinjiang province.
Well, it's clearly a major concern to us in the UK, and we're seeing a period in which China is asserting itself much more on the world stage, but yet isn't yet part of that global consensus or the fora really where we can hammer out the global compromises that are needed. China tends to be a much more passive member of the UN Security Council, for example. And China often presents a strong case that actually it needs a louder voice in those fora. And I think the last few years have shown that perhaps that would help if we had somewhere where we could work through these differences, because it's very clear that the Chinese economy is going to overtake the American economy in the next 20 or 30 years. And that, of course, has huge implications for statecraft and diplomacy. I think for the Brits, when they look at this context, it makes us even more worried about the fragility of some of our Western alliances, as you alluded to them. You know, it makes us more nervous that we have an administration in Washington that seems to be intent on vandalizing the UN, NATO, and other relationships which for us are load-bearing. You know, it's very difficult for us to see how we can present a common front against some of these new challenges and Russia under Putin is another of those challenges, unless we have those load-bearing relationships. And actually some of the actions taken on NATO and the UN in the last few years have really looked to us like huge own goals.
If Biden does get elected, do you expect a kind of reassertion of a more traditional foreign policy with an emphasis on NATO, with an emphasis on the rules-based international order?
Yes, I mean, I think the world has obviously moved on, and so it's probably not fair on Biden and his advisors to simply assume that they will transplant the foreign policy of the Obama-Biden years into the 2020s. But I'm certain that you will see a pull on the lever back towards alliance building, back towards support for that global rules-based international system. I know that my own country has not always shown the commitment in recent months to the international law that we like to pride ourselves on. But I hope that there'll be a reset globally and that it will be much, much easier for these international institutions to reassert themselves. Because frankly, the last few years, the UN, it's 75 last week, it has felt at times as though it's been orphaned by the American administration. And of course, we're used to America sort of moving in and out in terms of international engagement. I think we probably, the global community probably tends to criticize America for being too detached and then criticize them for being too engaged. But I think there's that real hope and demand, aspiration that we see, you know, the shining city on a hill reemerge when it comes to being that beacon for human rights and international law and freedom in the world.
Tom, I'd like to ask you a question. I normally would not have asked you if you had if you were still a diplomat, because it's a little bit impolitic. But now that you're in academia, I feel unleashed. Could you you've worked at the highest levels of British politics, the highest levels of government service, more accurately, in the Foreign Office at number 10. Could you do a little bit of comparison and contrast between the leaders, Prime Minister Johnson and President Trump? And I don't mean just superficially. I mean, you could interpret that question in terms of policies. You could also interpret it in terms of their kind of very direct communication style. And then we can get to COVID later.
So I lived through in Downing Street. I was there at the end of Blair Bush. And so we'd sit there on the video conferences between Blair and Bush, always with Dick Cheney sat in the foreground of the American videos, taking up half the screen, and often sipping very loudly from a milkshake. And then I was there for then Bush Brown, as we tried to get the continuity in the relationship, very different relationship, much more focused on the economic crisis. And of course, Gordon Brown coming in as a finance minister with a more economic approach to the world. Then I was there then as we went to Gordon Brown and Barack Obama. And actually, as many people said at the time, a slightly choppy early days as that White House settled in to really understanding how those sorts of relationships worked and the difficulties that we had with our media that I mentioned. And then I was there for the first year of Barack Obama's relationship with David Cameron. You know, two men closer in age. And in some respects, in parts of their outlook. And at each of those transitions, it's nerve-wracking for the advisors. You are working through the night to try and establish the personal rapport and trust between the leaders, because that then influences the whole relationship. I felt that probably the relationship between Donald Trump and Theresa May was never destined to be all that close. Now, I'm not putting too much blame on either side for that, although I think Donald Trump struggles to maintain what many of us would regard as healthy relationships with strong women leaders. He sort of struggles with that as a concept. But I also think that they were very, very different in temperament and outlook. Now, with Boris Johnson and Donald Trump, I think superficially a lot of people see more similarities. Not least the blondness and the bounce and the sense that these are both very charismatic, energetic individuals.
And they were both born in New York City.
Born in New York City. I think people have read too much into those similarities. I would say from my interactions with Boris Johnson, there is actually quite an erudite hinterland that isn't always so evident. This is someone who has read and studied history in real detail and knows global politics much more intimately than people realize. And so some of that doesn't always come through. I don't see him as the British Trump, as Donald Trump occasionally claims. And I think there are a number of areas where Boris Johnson has really worked hard to differentiate himself from Donald Trump around climate change, around the Iran deal in the Middle East, for example, around some of the rhetoric on migration and the movement of people and issues around Africa and the Middle East. So I think there are actually more differences than people realize. And it was quite striking in the last few years that when Donald Trump made his state visit to the UK, there was pretty much consensus across the political divide that this was not something that people felt should have happened. People felt that the Queen had been put in quite an uncomfortable position by having to roll out the red carpet and the silver service and the gold carriage at that time. And Donald Trump was very keen on the gold carriage, as you can imagine. So I think there is a kind of bipartisan skepticism in the UK about Donald Trump. And so Boris Johnson has to tread quite a fine line.
Very, very interesting. I certainly, as someone who's had to read, who's read the books of Boris Johnson with pleasure, and the books of Donald Trump more out of a sense of duty, there's some very interesting differences that emerge from those texts as well. I'm curious about one more point of comparison, you know, other than perhaps Brazil's president, Jair Bolsonaro, perhaps the two world leaders now who've come down with the virus have been Johnson and Trump. And I'm curious about, you know, how that's being received, how today's news is being received in Britain, how, you know, do people see Trump as much more anti-science or anti-evidence than, say, Johnson? And then also, of course, you know, I think the whole world was moved when Johnson was hospitalized. He spoke so movingly and very, and seemed genuinely kind of humbled by the experience and spoke very warmly of the NHS. Could you, you know, do a little bit of comparison and give us a sense of what we might expect?
Yeah, I mean, so I've been quite struck today. I mean, obviously on Twitter, there is talk of little else. And there is inevitably, there are parts of Twitter who are, which are rejoicing in some ways at the irony of this whole situation. There's a certain amount of schadenfreude about a president who told people not to bother wearing masks, now suffering from the virus. But I think at a deeper level, there is more sympathy at a human level. And I'm glad to see that, because you know, even if he has put people at risk, I don't think anyone can be rejoicing at the misfortune of an individual in that way. I think as the dust settles and people become less shocked by the initial news, the conversation will shift to what this means for the stability of the US and therefore for our alliances and the prospects for the elections. And there, I think there is real uncertainty about what comes next, what this means for the polls and what this means for the next debate, and then what this means for whether we will have a President Trump or a President Biden in the future. So that's where the conversation will shift. You know, I think it's no, as I've more than hinted, it would be no shock that if we had a vote in Britain tomorrow, President Biden would win quite easily. But there is concern now about the instability in geopolitics and in the markets that this situation may create. I have to say that one really important difference in your situation now and the situation for Boris Johnson a few months ago is that constitutionally it's much clearer what happens in the US if the president is incapacitated. Whereas in the UK, which relies on a much more informal constitution, you know, we don't have a deputy prime minister at the moment. At the time when Boris Johnson was sick, several other key members of government were also very sick. And so there was a different level of uncertainty. There was a real feeling of shakiness. Whereas at least in the States, we know what happens if he is incapacitated.
I find that argument so fascinating, Tom. I mean, it's true that there is a clearly specified line of succession, but there's so much other uncertainty right now. There are a lot of things where the law is silent. For example, if, you know, heaven forbid, one of the two nominees were to pass away before the election, the party could name the replacement, but actually getting their name onto the ballot would be one real thorny issue because the states are completely vary in their approaches to that problem. And then there's an even more fundamental constitutional issue about whether the electors would be bound to vote for the people to whom they were pledged, or if they could transfer their allegiance to their party's new nominee. And you'd think that would be obvious, but that too isn't spelled out. So there have been very, very interesting discussions about places where the Constitution and the enacting legislation is silent, which is really very, very interesting. I hope that none of these discussions go beyond the level of abstraction.
Yeah. Incidentally, I have with me a souvenir from my time in Number 10, because Marine Force One is so much part of the story today about where the transmission of the virus might have taken place. This model of Marine Force One was given to me by the Prime Minister when I left Downing Street, because there'd been a moment when our helicopter broke down. And so I went to Rahm Emanuel at the time as Chief of Staff and said, do you have some seats on the President's plane? And he very generously gave us two seats. So one was for the Prime Minister, and then one of the other advisors and I then had to toss a coin to see who would get to travel on Marine Force One with Barack Obama, you know, the story you would dine out on forevermore. I lost the bet. I lost the toss of the coin, and so I ended up with the model Marine Force One and not the ride on the real thing.
Having seen, having worked with and observed, you know, presidents of different parties and different persuasions, do you have any thoughts about whether America has kind of fundamentally been changed by the Trump era?
So it's, I think it's interesting when we think about this in the context of American soft power. I was often very struck that I could go around universities in the Middle East and the first three questions would be about Britain's colonial past, imperial past, and people's real sense of anger and resentment at that. But they would often be asked by people who were wearing Liverpool t-shirts or Man United t-shirts, who felt a cultural appreciation and a link to the UK. And I think that that is resilient in terms of America's magnetism. I think that survives Trump. Now, I think if we did similar polling to this across the UK community, you'd find distaste for the current president and real fear about the direction he's taken the US in. But I think you would still find a sense that the underlying values are still there and the appreciation of the of American culture and society is still as strong as ever. So I do think that can certainly survive one term. Can it survive two terms? Is tougher to foresee, but there is that underlying appreciation, and I don't think that's gone away. It's interesting in the polling, by the way, to see that sense of shared values coming out so strongly.
Yeah, even more than political leadership, and even more than the cultural ties. And you know, here in Los Angeles, certainly, you know, there's actually a very sizable British community working in U.S. working in global television and film and music. It's a surprisingly very, very international scene, just because there's, you know, so much of the film and TV production now is truly for a global audience, Netflix, HBO, etc. Could you tell us a little bit about what's likely to be going on right now behind the scenes at the Foreign Office at number 10, in preparation for a possible transition of power, and if not, then you know, in preparation for a second Trump administration with perhaps new priorities and really an enhanced standing.
So when you think about the interests of the UK, as opposed to the kind of personality politics that the media will be fascinated by, we need a trade deal, clearly, on the other side of Brexit. We need, whoever is president, that renewal of commitment to the international rules-based system and to the NATO alliance and to the UN and to a system of global governance, however imperfect, as a less bad option than the isolationism and extremism we're seeing in much of the world. So diplomats, I think, on both sides will be working out how do we move fastest post-election to try and really cement those aspects of the relationship. But then inevitably, as we've touched on, a huge part of this will depend on the personalities involved. And so I think there'll be a lot of work behind the scenes to reach out now to key advisors on both sides. To try to ensure that relationship starts off on the right footing. Every time a new American president arrives, in my experience in number 10, the big demand is to get the first call in. You want to be the first foreign leader that they call. And we would fight very, very hard for that position. It often comes down to how well you know the different advisors, but it's a signal of where you are in the ranking at that time. So there'll be work going into things like that, which seem a bit of a sideshow, but they do mean quite a lot to the public. All of this, by the way, is happening, of course, in the context of people's worries about the security of the diplomatic communication. And you know, the Brits were stung in the transition to Barack Obama by leaks of embassy cables. Then the then ambassador Nigel Sheinwald has his telegrams leaked. Any ambassador should be reporting candidly to their capital about the pros and the strengths and weaknesses of the incoming president. But you don't want to read that in the Washington Post or in the New York Times. And then, of course, more recently, Kim Darroch, our last ambassador, was very, very badly stung by leaks. You know, of course, Donald Trump had a less thick skin than Barack Obama when it came to references to him. So, while making all these candid judgments, I'm certain our current ambassador, who's absolutely brilliant, Karen Pierce, will be making sure that they're transmitted at a very high level of secrecy in order that she can really speak truth to power.
Oh, that's such a fascinating point. Has the state-sponsored disinformation campaign coming from Russia and similar efforts perhaps coming from China or other state actors, has that made frank use of diplomatic channels more difficult, more challenging?
Much more. And I think there's more of that to come. I led a review of the British Foreign Office 4 years ago, and we had to make that judgment between pace of communication and that freedom to communicate on the move that you need your diplomats to have, balanced against security. And actually, we opted to notch it towards the freedom and away from securing the communications, because there's such a need for us to get our message in quickly to our ministers, our political leaders from the field. But that's left us even more exposed to these potential breaches. And I think one thing we all underestimated, I certainly underestimated it when I wrote the book, was the extent to which some of our opponents in this space would be able to weaponize the internet against us. And in the last 4 or 5 years, we've all learned that lesson in quite dramatic ways.
Tom, if you don't mind, let's go to some questions from our participants. One question, can you comment on the role of soft power diplomacy today and whether the US and the UK are sufficiently resourced and focused on this as a discipline in an era when public budgets are under such strain?
So I've argued this, that soft power, and Joseph Nye was of course the originator of the concept, is becoming more and more important, and that balance with the hard power is moving towards the soft power side. That magnetism that you can exert as a country, which of course doesn't always come top down. It's not always from the government. It's often from the kinds of folk you're talking about in LA, or the American filmmakers who are sort of preserving a sense of America's magnetism, whoever's in the White House. That soft power is often very difficult to invent. It's very difficult to shift a country's image. I do an exercise with students where we say the first three words that come to mind when you mention Brazil or India and China, and those are quite consistent. It's quite difficult to shift someone's perception. Now, the second part of so it matters hugely, it matters more and more. Will matter more in the future. Educational links, sporting links. I mentioned, the Premiership football is such a key export for us. I noticed the royal family popping up in the polling as an important part of our soft power. The tendency has been for the US and UK to basically leave some of the tools of soft power lying around. We're not very good at actually strategizing how to build our soft power. We've been a bit complacent. We figure that we've got this big advantage of our culture, this big advantage of our language, which is effectively the world's language. So we've got these head starts, but I think we under-resource our soft power effort compared to much of the competition. And looking around the world now, you see increasing investment. Every year, the Soft Power 30 table comes out. We have a seminar on this next week. The countries just outside the top 10 are massively investing in what's the story they tell the world, and what are the tools you then need to go out and tell that story, and then the structures to allow that to happen. Whereas the UK and America, the UK has the British Council, which is a fantastic soft power vehicle, but it does tend to be under-resourced compared to the competition. And I know that US funding for soft power has been decreasing in recent years. So I hope that whoever comes through the election will restore more energy to promotion of soft power.
Another question, how has social distancing affected diplomatic practice? Can diplomacy be done as effectively virtually as it can be in person?
So social distancing, I mean, the problem is actually that the pandemic has led to national distancing as well as social distancing. And so it's fed this climate of isolationism and nationalism and countries basically going it alone. But for the craft of diplomacy, obviously that social distancing has had a big impact. Some of it is actually positive. I love the fact that diplomats aren't boasting anymore about the number of air miles they have. I love the fact that diplomats and statespeople are not assuming that the answer to every problem in the 21st century is one more international conference. But it's clearly a challenge for a profession where the handshake is effectively the sign that you've done your job well, and a craft which relies so much on what Edward Murrow called the last 3 feet, that human connection. I think diplomats have been surprised, like many of us, at how much they can do on Zoom and so on. But in my experience, many of them find that it works as a tool where you have an existing personal rapport. So if you know your counterpart as a foreign minister, then actually moving your meetings onto Zoom is quite efficient and quite straightforward. But where you don't have that relationship and you don't have the chance to sit down and break bread together, establish a human rapport, the social distancing becomes much more of a challenge. I think the other big challenge for diplomacy is that the pandemic sucks in huge amounts of resource and time and energy, which means that there are a huge number of really big challenges. Coming back to Eisenhower again, the difference between the important and the urgent. There are many really important challenges, including some pretty live conflicts, which have been put to one side because, so many of the best people have focused completely on the pandemic. And I think that will be a big challenge for the 2020s.
The question about vaccine development, there has been a lot of coverage in the U.S. on political influence in the vaccine development process, also on the vaccine approval process, I might add. One of these vaccines is being produced at Oxford. How do British people view this? And how is vaccine development being handled in the UK? And that's a question from Mina Seshamani, who's also a healthcare practitioner herself.
Thanks, Mina. And it was interesting in the polling to see how keen people were that the progress was made in the US and the UK. There's that sense of actually the impact that would have on a country's soft power. I think several countries, including the US and the UK, have probably seen their reputations take a bit of a battering through the pandemic so far. The UK has lived off for several decades now a reputation for competence. It scores well on competence, a AAA rating for competence. And some of that has been shaken a bit by the pandemic. And some countries will come through as having managed this much more effectively than others. But whoever gets the vaccine, that's clearly a huge boost to their international reputation. And so there is enormous amounts of appetite from government, but from universities like my own here, that we're the first mover into that space. And huge pride that Oxford is, as things stand, one of the leaders of the pack on finding the vaccination, but also on finding new ways to test. I have two professors at Hertford College who are, really at the most innovative end of piloting the tests which will help us get through the period until the vaccine is readily available. So I think everyone is really conscious that that's space that we want to be in, and that we mustn't just be sat here as a university passively letting the pandemic happen to us. We actually have our best people out on the front line coming out with the ingenious solutions that may help us manage and end this pandemic.
That's very heartening. You talked a little bit a moment earlier about national distancing, and I'm curious about where you feel the nationalist trend is going. Certainly having lived in the UK 2015 to 17, during the Brexit vote, but also during immense challenges posed by the migration coming out of the Syria and Middle East refugee crises, and also, of course, the terror that was wreaked by ISIS and other Islamist groups. It seemed that the nation state was really kind of after a period when it was assumed that that nationalisms were declining, they seemed to have roared back very strongly. And I'm curious if you see a kind of do you feel any, is there any cause to be optimistic about a potential rebalancing after the pandemic is over? Has the pandemic reinforced the need for mutual dependence and international cooperation, or rather has it fostered a kind of tragedy of the commons in which each country is going its own way?
I think you've hit the nail on the head there. It's one of the great ironies of this pandemic that a virus that has defied national borders and shown how much we rely on each other has actually increased that national distancing and increase that sense that we must go it alone because of the fragility of those international structures, the weakness of those international structures. You know, I don't think we should be surprised that the last 5 years have seen these sorts of trends. When you think back, you know, I was sat there in 2008 in the room with Gordon Brown as UK Prime Minister, with Barack Obama and others, at the when we brought the world together at the G20 summit in London in January 2009. And as they pieced together the response, it was Obama who said, "You realise that if we don't fix the systems for international cooperation, the next crisis is going to be even harder to manage." And I think at that moment, everyone in that room felt that the implications of the crash of 2008 could be as great as the implications of the crash of 29, that we could be facing a lost decade, not just the hit on the economy, but that we could see the rise of this extremism and nationalism on both extreme and polarization, as we did in the 20s and 30s. And of course, that, you know, we've seen that accelerate since the crash, and we've seen the systems fall apart in response. I do think that as we emerge from the pandemic, though, I think the pendulum will swing back. And that's mainly because of the sense of agency and activism of younger generations, particularly around climate. And I think it will become clearer than ever that we have to do something on the climate through rapidly in the 2020s, and that we simply can't do that without stronger systems of international cooperation. I was really struck by Andy Burnham, who, by the way, is a fantastic mayor and a great example of why we were right to steal from America the idea of empowering mayors more. I liked what he was saying about the need to find a vaccination against inequality and injustice. I do think that those voices will be louder as we emerge, and that we'll probably see a backlash against almost anyone who is in power in this era, but particularly against the populists and the nationalists. That's my hope.
I could go on with you for hours, but one final question, if you don't mind. Do you also see the pendulum swinging back when it comes to confidence in democracy itself? You know, there's very, very troubling social science research suggesting that the world has been in a kind of democratic recession since 2006 or so. You know, that there, after growing enormously in the 1990s and early aughts, the number of democracies, the quality of democracies, there now seems to be a crisis of confidence among some democracies. Certainly, COVID-19 has, you know, kind of put side by side the kind of, I'm not sure it's a model, but the kind of the China vision of a kind of very authoritarian state-led, giant state-led mobilization, almost on a war level footing, you know, versus, you know, the challenges that more open societies have faced in terms of unifying citizens in a for common purpose and being effective, and ultimately, you know, legitimation, I believe, comes in part from efficacy, from results. And I think there is a kind of crisis of confidence right now. Where do you see that playing out?
So there is certainly that broader crisis of confidence, and I think the pandemic has accentuated that. Although it'll be interesting to see as we come out of this, will people migrate towards authoritarian countries or away from them? You know, that's in the end the test, is which systems are more magnetic. Do people migrate towards systems that are perceived to have responded well, you know, health systems that are more developed, or do they go towards freedom? And I suspect, but let's meet in 10 years' time and see what the outcome of that. So I think we have two big challenges. Anyone who believes in our democratic model. One is that democracies are not necessarily delivering that well on people's basic aspirations because they have become so short-term, because there's been such a turnover, because we are so unable, it seems, to think about strategy. You know, I was living in Abu Dhabi recently, and they have a 2071 plan. In most countries, in most democracies, we can barely think into, you know, tomorrow. So we've got to get better at doing delivery. It's not enough to simply talk about our values. We have to show that our values then deliver for change in people's lives. The other big challenge really comes, I think, from trust. And trust is falling in anything that looks like a hierarchy or authority. We know that from the Pew research and other kinds of research, that trust is falling in doctors and teachers and the police and diplomats, and not just in politicians or the media. And so we have to find ways to communicate more effectively with people and explain why what we do matters. And in particular, we have to use digital technology to do that, because other systems seem to be more effective at the moment at coupling the efficiency that, that digital technology gives them with their political models. Whereas we haven't really upgraded our democracy for the technology around us, for an age of social media, for a moment where people feel this sense of agency. You know, they can tap a button on their smartphone and they get quick results. And yet when it comes to their democratic choices, they feel they have less and less power and influence. So we have to find ways to upgrade our diplomacy for the, you know, for this age of such rapid tech change.
Tom, thanks so much for such a rich conversation and for sharing your deep insights. This has been really, really stimulating. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. It's a real pleasure to join you. And thank you, Neil. And enjoy the rest of the event.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Tom. Thank you, Sewell. What a pleasure. We're so grateful for your insights and really valuable reflections on the state and future of our alliance and what's happening with the diplomacy more broadly between our two countries. Thank you all for participating in the 2020 Marshall Forum.